Hello and welcome to the GPhoto2Server demo. This is a demo of a new version of GPhoto2Server, the version 2.1. This is the very recent version, I just made it, and it has some pretty cool features. Now let me show this thing to you, and I'm showing it this way just so it would look more as it's supposed to be, as it would be used on a smartphone. So these proportions for the screen would be more correct, let's say so. And I'm using the Nikon D5100. So I would just recently I had the chance to test the GPhoto2Server with Nikon, but it works, seems to work pretty well. So the most important feature in the GPhoto2Server, if you're familiar with it already, you know this is the ability to control your camera by setting all those configuration properties, let's say so. But that's in the GPhoto2 library. It uses the GPhoto2 library, the open source library, for controlling the cameras, and it provides the web interface for all the things that that library does. In the library's terminology, these things I could call the config settings. Also, I would probably not call them this way, it's something like a camera properties, rather. This camera has lots of properties exported, but there are some properties that you're more interested in, and the others that you're less interested in, like, let's say, an ISO speed. So, here is the ISO speed. We can change the property right here, and if you change it, there was a little, for a second you could see there a progress indicator, and the setting is now applied. So this checkbox allows you to mark some properties as your favorites, and then here you can choose to only show your favorites. It's a very convenient way to just filter out all the noise, you know, mark some of favorites and only use those. We have a live view in the GPhoto2Server. We can now use the live view because I've implemented the Java native access bridge that allows me to use the native library GPhoto2 to capture the previous with a very very high speed. So as you can see, it works pretty fine, but it's running currently on a MacBook Pro. If I would run it on something weak like a Raspberry Pi and would connect to it over Wi-Fi, it would of course be slower, but still, this is pretty cool, in my opinion. And you can do stuff like capture right away while not going away from a live view. The capture on the Nikon, and most operations on the Nikon seem to take a little while, because when it connects to the PC, it kind of uses some time. And while I've been doing this on Canon, I could like change an ISO speed and see in the preview it would be reflected by having a darker picture, much darker picture, and then setting a higher ISO would produce a much brighter picture. But in an Nikon, for some reason, those settings do not affect the preview, and I'm not too happy about that, but I have an Nikon right away, right now on my hands. I'm going to go on with that. Anyway, you can see that we can change settings on the fly and actually apply the preview. Is actually in the background, the preview stopped, the setting has changed, and then preview is restarted, because I cannot do two things at once with the camera. And still, it works pretty fine. I use the JPEG. Let's try. Actually, I will try the JPEG in RAW later. So this is just one of the features, but there are more. And in the Canon cameras and in the Nikon cameras, you can browse the file system and download right away those pictures that we just made. You see, this one is very bright. Did I make anything with the low ISO? These are all the pictures I made before. So anyway, one thing that I haven't added yet is the possibility to bulk delete pictures. But that's not the most important thing. I will probably add it later. I have time for the small stuff. Currently, let me just delete all those JPEGs there, and we will create some using the new feature, the scripting. the scripting was there before in previous version, but it wasn't implemented in the right way. It was the scripting worked in a browser. So if you close the browser with, or if your Wi-Fi connection between the browser and the GPhoto server went slow or something happened, or you just like on an iPhone, you if you want to the home screen, everything in the browser stops working. So now the scripting will all work in the server side, so you can do whatever you want, disconnect, close the browser, whatever. The script will continue to work until you log in again back to the GPhoto2 server and tell it to stop the script. You have the buttons to list existing scripts and create a new one. So when you create a new one, you can type a name, of course. And when from those scripts, you can delete them, or you can just click on them and they will load in this editor where you can change stuff about the scripts. And you have a little help here. If you click this variables provider scripts, click the show hide. If you click it, you see a little help about the variables that are available to you in the scripts. Because in the script, you can now provide expressions for a condition, like if an expression validates the true, then only then the step will be executed. If you provide no expression, it will be always executed. If you want to like disable, you can put false, and it will never be executed. Of course, that's not very useful, so we will not do that. You can see if we change something on the script and then we try like to load a different script, it asks us whether we want to change us and change this first. This was actually the same script. I clicked the script that is exactly the same as the one I've changed. But anyway, the software is not that smart. It just sees that you want to load something. The script in the editor is not matched by the name. Anyway, the script itself, you can add steps, move them, rearrange, and the steps can be of the one of those kind, like a capture a photo. This will actually produce now a capture file variable. It will put in the capture file variable the path in the camera file system to the full file. You can do the usual weight, and you can in the weight you can put the number here, or you can put some expression like let me show you a good example of that in one of the scripts here. No. Which one? This is the one. Like we have this variable current time in milliseconds that's provided to us, and I put it into loop start time. So when the script begins, the script is always executed in loops. Like whenever it reaches the last step, it just goes on to the first step. So whenever I run the first step, I will put into the variable loop start time, the current time in milliseconds. And whenever I go to the step before the last one, I actually want the loops not to execute as fast as possible, like the capture. I'm doing the capture photo, and this may take different time depending on something the camera is doing and depending on the shutter speed, which I might change, and I am changing in the script the shutter speed. Because of that, I want the weight to actually take this into account. So I'm taking the start time, and I'm taking the time at this step, subtract the start time I have set into variable. So I subtract the current time from the start time, and I get the amount of milliseconds that has passed since this step to this step. And then from 6,000 milliseconds, which is just 6 seconds, I subtract that amount, and I'm going to wait for this particular amount. So this is how we can make the loops execute in a specific with a specific frequency, let's say. So actually I'm going to put 8 here, because when I do more than 8 seconds, this value might even become negative with some with a Nikon camera. It's relatively slow in with doing stuff. Well, actually 6 seconds was good enough as far as I remember, but if you go to higher shutter speeds, the lower shutter speeds, the higher values for the delay, for the lens of the exposure, yeah, the higher values for the exposure, like 3 seconds, 4, 5 seconds, this scene takes like 4 seconds, something almost 5 seconds, the capture. For some reason, the Nikon is very slow to capture, and then it kind of reconnects to the PC, and which is weird, and it takes a while. I don't enjoy that in the Nikon. I actually preferred my Canon, where it worked much faster for that. But I have only Nikon on my hands now, so we'll go on with that. And And this takes almost 5 seconds, and if I put higher exposure times, like 3 seconds, then this will take probably like 8 seconds, so this is going to be a negative value. And if you do wait time for the negative value, it will just will not wait. It will think that you passed it zero. So I have the the safeguard, let's say. So yeah, the safeguard put in place for that. And I'm actually not doing the wait here, I'm actually putting this in the variable so I could see it, and then I have the wait time, because later when I execute script I can actually see the values of the variables. So this script is pretty interesting, but let me just go ahead. For this camera photon wait, we have a wait camera event scene, and this await camera event scene, let me just add a new stuff for that. You can choose a kind of event that you're going to wait for and the amount, because sometimes on the snacking camera it doesn't have it. Apparently whenever I do stuff with it, I tell it command to like set a camera property, so the shutter speed, or do a capture, it does the scene and only then it returns. But sometimes Canon I had this, that I told it to do like a capture photo and it returns, but it's still busy with something, so if next command is trying to execute, error occurs, and the error occurs somewhere inside this GPhoto2 library, so everything crashes badly. So you have to do this wait for camera event, like a capture done sometimes. So I'm not sure if it's completely necessary, maybe it's not going to actually be needed, but just in case it's going to be needed, it's there. Set camera properties, of course, setting one of the camera properties available there, and that's the most useful one. And you can put an expressions here too for that. And then you have the ability to set the variable. So you could put a variable name here, and you put an expression here. The variable name, you can't do anything stupid with that. It should be like the Latin letters, and it can have the numbers, but not, it cannot start with the number. Can have underscores, yada yada. So, same as I'm using the variables like you see here to calculate stuff, and like the wait, this wait time there, and also the capture is going to put the path to the captured file inside the variable now called capture file, actually dash dash capture file, and I mean underscore underscore capture file. Anyway, and then we will use this light meter feature. The light meter feature can get you the light end for the preview or the light end for a captured file. It's going to work faster for the preview, and for the captured file it's going to be slower, but the preview, especially on this Nikon, seems to be automatically adjusted for the light, so it's not going to give us a proper value. We won't actually know how bright or dark the picture is, so we could probably adjust our shutter speed for that, but currently I'm not doing this in the script, but at least I'm going to show you that this thing works. And another thing that on a Canon cameras often let me delete this unnecessary stuff. I haven't deleted it. Let me revert the script to what it was. So on a Canon cameras you cannot access the camera file system until you close the viewfinder. So it might be necessary to put an extra step here to close the viewfinder. And by the way, the editor, in the editor you can move the steps around, like if you push this up or this down button, like those steps change switch sides, you can delete particular steps, etc. So it should be pretty convenient. And then the scene is about browsing the files are also, like in Nikon, this doesn't seem to have any effect. Let me reload that, because you have to actually push reload sometimes. But on the Canon, when the viewfinder is on, and it's usually after the you do the live view, let me reload again and see, the viewfinder became on. So it's open, actually. While the viewfinder is open, on a Canon, I cannot browse the file system. It doesn't allow me, it actually wants me to switch the viewfinder off first, and only then it gives me the access to the file system. On Nikon this doesn't seem to be necessary. Well, it apparently it is unnecessary, I can still browse the file system and with the viewfinder on, but it's something to be accounted for. And this get for camera file, like meter get for camera file thing, also accesses the file system, so just make sure if you're going to be doing this for Canon to close the viewfinder first. After caption photo, it will probably still be open, by the way, so in a script like that, I would still want to close it. So let's just run the script now and see how it works. And we have a couple of buttons like run and stop, and we have a couple of things here that I want to show as a status screen. It's for the currently running and for the latest finished. And I have already a latest finished. I have been running some scripts, so I have some finished there. And this is the name of script, number of step it was on when it finished, total loop counts, like how many times it's executed all the steps there, and total steps count, like 22 steps in total, and all those variables that were set. And there were some variables. I already had the light meter engaged and the captured file. You can see it tells me to where it captured the file. So. And some of the things, like loop count, it's also a variable, so it's available to your script. You can do stuff like if loop count more than 10, and it means it's only on the 11th loop, or actually, since we start from 0, it will be 12 essentially, but it will have loop count 11. Only when the loop count is 11, this step will be executed. We don't need this actually, but there is the possibility to do things like that now for every step. So they kind of do, you know, like 100 shots with a particular setting, and on the 101st shot you can start changing the setting, etc. Like control the focus and that sort of thing. Let's actually run the script. When I push the run, it's going to end execution, but I don't know anything about that. I can push the currently running to actually see what's going on. I can push it continuously to retrieve the stats, or I can just enable this auto retrieval. This auto retrieval is convenient, but not convenient enough. Actually, we have this cool feature called tracing. And when I push this button, it actually reloads this editor with the specific steps, because, you know, after you pushed run, you could load some different scripts, etc. It reloads this editor with the specific steps of a script that is executing currently, and the script doesn't change even if you edit it. After you started the script, it gets loaded into memory and those steps are getting executed, and then you can edit the same file, but those steps in memory, they don't change. So when you push the trace and they get reloaded from memory on the server in here, so you will see the exact steps. So the thing is, if nothing's running and you push this start tracing, this editor will be blanked, so because it's nothing running. I will show it to you later, but there's something to be aware of. So now this is running, and I use the WebSocket to push the data to the browser whenever something changes on the server, and we see all those nice variables. We can see the wait time, by the way, because I could have, instead of set variable, I could have put the wait right here and just use expression, but I put it into the wait time, so we would be able to see how different it is. And actually, you can see it changes a bit, even though I'm changing this camera config. It has the string value, and I see this is actually the previous value of what it had, because when I use this set camera property, first thing it's done is the camera property is retrieved and set into the variable, and then its value is set, but it's not retrieved again, so we kind of see the previous value here. And we have this string value of 16s. This is taken from those options that it has here, like 16s is going to go to 2, 2 and 5, 3. That's what I run on the script. Those options are called choices here. So if you look at the code, it says comprop.choices, and then since this is array, I use the square brackets, and the square brackets I take like loop count plus 20, so I would skip the first choices, and modulus of a camera property choices size, so it will not go out of the array. Like there are, like, I don't know, whatever, 100 choices, so I will go to 101, and because then I would get an error, and the errors will be displayed in here too, by the way. So, oh, you see, we already got into the negative times because we have the long exposures. Yeah, and that's the power of scripting. We also have the light metering. I wanted to demo that. So let us skip this step. And let us let us change the shutter speed to something more appropriate. It's already went through all those values up to 10. Let me put it to something short there. And in the script I've disabled the step completely, so shutter speed won't be changing. And I want to show you how the light metering will change when I will do things with the camera. Like the light is 17% now. The light meters in 17 point something. The 18. That's because the light changes a little bit in the room, but not too much. So I'm going to take the camera now and point it to something. You can't see it, but I'm going to point it to a bright light. All right. So the light is 94%. Very bright. Yeah, I'm having the ISO speed down. And now I'm going to just take it away and put it back to where it was. Alright, it might be shot in the dark just now, so what's it gonna be? It's 31%. So, as you can see, we can use this light and metering to actually then adjust for shutter speeds or stuff like that. We can use the scripting facility to put them in an array, so we would have like a last, I don't know, 10, 12, 100 values, and we can average over those values and only adjust the shutter speed if we see that over 100 values the light went down or something like this. It could probably be used for the day to night time lapses, things like that. So you see, this is nice tracing, highlights the steps that are happening, and we can disable this variable dumps, and it will remove all the other variables except the one that that have to be displayed here, like the current step, the loop count, and the total steps count. So they are also provided as variables to script, so that's all included. This thing is just there in case this tracing doesn't work fast enough, so in order to send less data, or maybe you have lots of variables, I include this feature so you can enable or disable the dumping of all the variables. And same thing applies to those future possibilities to load the configs. Like if I disable it and I load for the latest config, it also doesn't show the okay, I've loaded it for the latest config, and then this thing changed it, because every time something happens again, it updates this display too. Alright, let's just stop there, and I wanted to show you how those files were produced with the increasing shutter speeds. I don't know now, I've made a lot of shots, which ones are from the scripts when the shutter speed was increasing and which one from the slow one, but we'll just check. Like this one, yeah, these were already pretty bright, so let's just open this one. 21, 22, 23, 24, 25. Let's see which ones are which. Okay, here you see the shutter speed was actually increasing, and they were getting brighter and brighter, so these were supposed to be more bright. 34, 35. Yep, these are exactly those. And then I changed at a certain point, changed the shutter speed to some small one and started the script. I guess it will be on the 56, it's going to be already dark, but 44 might still be. Oh no, these are already the dark ones. And one of them should be actually the bright one, because I've been pointing the camera to the lamp. Ah, here it is. Yeah, this, remember when the light meter showed the high value? This was it. So, as you can see, the scripts are quite powerful now. Not only we can meter the light, we can also change the properties in a scripted way, like the property that has a set of values, specifically the shutter speed, and we can know what kind of values it has by just looking it up here. These values are represented as choices array for the camera property, and we can just tell it to set the shutter speed not to some predefined value, but to some of those choices. And in the choices, I just need to provide an index in the array, and I can calculate it from a loop count or from whatever any variables that I have there. I can even like use the light metering to graduate the light metering to use some function to convert the light metering to the particular shutter speed. Things like that. So this is pretty cool, I suppose. And let me also show you how the some errors are handled. There can be errors in your scripts, like in this case we're using the test variable, but it was never assigned first, so it was never defined. So I'm using this trick here. The problem is the Jaxel engine that I'm using for evaluation, it actually complains about it, since you can just, you know, like take a variable and check it for if it's not equal to 1. If the variable was never defined, it's not just going to tell you that no, it's not equal, it's actually going to fail with an error. So that's a bit of a problem, and the only way to check for the undefined variables in Jaxel is this using a ternary operator. If you don't know what ternary operator is, it evaluates the value before the question mark, and if it evaluates to true, then it will execute the first thing. And true is anything like undefined is false, zero, actual zero integer is false, boolean false is false, everything else is true. So it will execute this part, and it actually will return this part, not execute. I will calculate and return it. So we can put like an x here, and x will become equal to what's calculated from here. And if this is actually false, it will do this part. So x will become 1. So as soon as one test variable is undefined, it evaluates to false, and that's the only case way to evaluate it to something when it's undefined. It's using this ternary operator. So whenever it's undefined, it's going to the result of this expression will be 1. And we are assigning it back to test var. And next time it's already been defined, it will have a var 1 value. So when this check is checked, it returns true. So then the returned value is 1 plus, and here will be 1, so it will be 2, and 2 will be assigned to test var. So then it's going 3, 4. So this is like a loop counter. Also, I'm providing you with a loop counter, so you wouldn't have to do this thing. But if you need to like assign variables to things conditionally, and you have like two options. You can put a very first step that would actually check like if the loop count is zero. So only on the very first loop you would assign a variable to somewhere like one. So then when it's not zero, it will, you will can just do the plus one here. You know, and it will not fail telling you that I don't know what this variable is. It is already defined by this step. But there is also an alternative way to do this. So it's like a cool way to do it. Let's say so. Okay, let's just run it, and tracing is already enabled. We have an error there because LightMeter doesn't have a function get. It has to get for preview, actually. Let's fix that. Okay, now it returns some light. It gets from the preview. I'm doing the capture photo here also, so we also have the names of the captured photo. We have the test variable there, and it increases, so loop count starts from 0, but test variable starts from 1, as we defined it. So you see, it kind of actually works, and it's always loop count plus 1. So, these are the scripting features in the new GPhoto2 server, and I think they are pretty cool. The tracing is nice when it highlights your values and shows you, but when I try this over Wi-Fi with my iPhone, it didn't work that well. It was behind, lagging behind often. So maybe the tracing should only be when you just when you create scripts like at home or something. But in the real shoots, you actually are not going to be using tracing once the script is fine. You will probably even not be looking it up with the statuses. You will just make it run and go do some stuff while it's running. But of course the tracing and this debugging is needed when you create a script and you want to make sure that they work correctly. And one thing that I wanted to show is the errors. Like, okay, let me stop the tracing. The thing is, when the errors occur, you want to see the last error here. and all the errors are recorded. So if you put the script, run the script that has an error, and the error here is that this is a ZXC parsing error. So evaluation error. Evaluation error means that either the condition of the expression cannot be evaluated, the error happened during the evaluation. And that's what the evaluation error means, and you can see that it's happened on the step number 0. And it's the step that does the wire set, yada yada. So, and you can see that this part ZXC is not known. So when I stop this, I'll finish the script, currently running, nothing's currently running, but if I go to the latest finish, I can also see not just the latest error, but all the errors. But the currently running script, I don't show that because if errors would accumulate, that will take more and more time to send all the errors. So only when the script is finished, then I will let you review all the errors that happened there, in case you just need to figure them all one by one, because there might be more than one. But still, the switcher is there, the errors don't like crash the application, etc. Also, probably you can type some very stupid expression here that will probably cause some issues. I mean, maybe not very stupid, but something very smart, like you can try to exploit like Mitsu, because it's a Java object and you can do get class and then do something with class loading. So this feature is dangerous. It potentially allows you to hack the application through it. But since you are not going to be using it on the public networks, I suppose, because the GPhoto server has no security so far. It has no password protection, etc. So you shouldn't be using it on the public Wi-Fi. So anyway, so this feature is the power. With great power comes great responsibility. Let's say so. But still, the errors are. It's really hard. It's probably going to be really hard for you to do something as tricky there, so you would actually crash the application. Application is not supposed to crash, and it's always supposed to catch your errors and show them to you. So that's the thing. All in all, I guess this is a pretty serious update, and the scripting feature and the light metering should allow you to do pretty wicked stuff, let's say, with the GPhoto server. And I should probably get some donations for that. I guess you guys have spent a lot of time working on it. But anyway, this GPhoto server is available for free at my GitHub. GPhoto2Server releases. This is the one, the 2.1 beta. You can just download the zip file and then run it by typing like java minus jar gp2SRV. 2.1.jar in the folder where this jar file is. You should go there and run this command in the terminal. I will probably include later the run bot and run sh files, so you could run like run bot on Windows. You wouldn't have to type yourself with jar, java minus jar, all the jazz, and so you could just double click and run it. Currently, I was still too busy doing the scripting soon and didn't see. I missed some smaller feature scenes like those startup scripts and the budget deletion, which is quite necessary like for this demo. But still, at least the most important scenes are there. So again, I hope you enjoy it, and go ahead, download and use it, do something great, create some time lapses, something. Okay, bye.